I know the Leafs won, but...
Let me guess, but they blew a 3-1 lead.
No, I know the Leafs won, but Tom Wilson also lost.
Oh, that's very true.
It's very true.
He does have a cup, though.
Yeah, pre-pandemic.
So true.
That was ages ago. Doesn't count.
Let's go!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a little ridiculous.
Good boy.
Play all the hits! Left Toronto Maple Leafs. Let me finish. How am I supposed to go to bed after watching that?
I'm quite hyped.
With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Even though the victory puppies are sleeping, Leafs win!
Ooh.
Leafs win! There it was, without the... Anyway, 5-3 over the Washington Capitals. Oh, the Leafs hate a 3-1 lead. They hate it. Whether they have one or they're facing one. It's done! And I gotta tell you, Leaf fans, I don't care. Like, that was good. That was good. All the way around. The whole time, it was good. Even when they blew the lead, it was good. Because a lot of games, you could say, yes, this happened, or yeah, that happened, but I watched this thing, and I thought it was great the whole time. Don't get me wrong, they've had some stinkers lately. They blew a 7-2 lead to Detroit, but context matters, and the context here is they were all taking turns pooping. Please don't demonetize me. The Leafs have won some really good, tight games against really strong opponents lately. Yes, the Blues, yes, the Flames, but the Penguins, that was a good one. The Hurricanes, that was a good one. The Wild, that was a good one. And this against the Capitals on the road in their barn for the first time in over 800 days was real good.
Let's talk about it.
Listen, to any member of the Toronto Maple Leafs organization that is watching this, I'm gonna tell you, like, I am willing to admit this fault. It's almost the trade deadline, and you can't take anything that we say seriously. This is when we're our most cranky and our most picky about everything.
What do we need?
Everything!
A little upgrade?
No, the best of everything!
What are you willing to pay?
Nothing!
It's not quite how it works.
Just do it, Kyle!
Here's Carter Hutton for nothing?
Ah!
Okay, not Carter Hutton for nothing. I'll try something else.
And one thing we have been spoiled with recently is hot starts. And Mitch Marner essentially putting on the hockey version of an and-one mixtape. Every game, Mitch Marner adds fuel to the conspiracy fire that he runs the Leafs TikTok account. Like, this dude's pulling off influencer moves in a game with NHL defenders on him. The long replay of the first goal is hilarious because it's Ilya Labushkin with the least graceful puck possession I've ever seen, but he holds on to it long enough to give it to Rasmus Sandin, who's sick. That pairing together again, I don't think they're coming apart. And the puck is in deep and the Caps are after it, but Mitch Marner dog it! Perifari gets it and he gets his pocket picked! Guaranteed Marner puts us on the Leafs TikTok by lunch tomorrow!
That rookie's floating in the air.
Did I do good? No, it was bad? Okay. I laughed. I hope you did too. He gives it to Michael Bunting for the tap-in for his 19th goal of the season. That is your rookie goal-scoring leader, Michael Bunting. The 48-year-old rookie Michael Bunting. I love it. And the Leafs are up 1-0 less than 3 minutes in. Now, the only guy on the top line that I didn't mention in that last play, Austin Matthews. Been in a lot of heart conversations recently, and that's because he's the top point getter on the Leafs and the top goal score in the league, but also, he's apparently the Leafs' best goalie at the moment. Jocko's off the post, hits Peter Mrazek in the back, and he's going for it, but he's not gonna get there in time! Austin Matthews with the stick, and he barely gets a hold of it. Just enough to keep it from fully crossing the line. It was like maybe 3/4 across the line, but that's not what the rule says. So it's still a 1-0 Leaf lead. Unfortunately, in the dying minutes of the first period, Connor Sherry standing right in front. The Leafs gotta be better in front, and the perfect tip beats Mrazek. You can't put that on anybody. Well, I mean, you can put it on the guy who should have had Sherry, but it's a good goal by the Caps, and Mrazek can't be expected to get a shot tipped that perfectly. Oh man, that's just, it's a terrible way to go into intermission. Oh, we're not at intermission. Oh, that's right, there's more stuff. The rest of the game is essentially a love letter to John Tavares. Second line back together, Kerfoot with William Nylander and John Tavares, all of whom are struggling. I mean, less so on the score sheet, and more so in that last game, they were struggling to keep liquids and solids in their body. Please don't demonetize, I need it. Look at my house. It's a lot of stuff. None of it's expensive. Anyway, this whole play is a love letter to John Tavares. First of all, just bullying John Carlson behind the net. That's how this whole play starts. The Leafs keep it alive, and they work it behind the net once again to who? John Tavares. The little thing king, grinding away on the boards, and oh, Barzeller was with him until he wasn't. Where are you going? You're lost. IKEA lost and found. He did such a good job that not only did he shake Lars Eller off, but he also made William Nylander invisible. Look at this. Look at that. He's right there. He's got 20 goals! He's about to have 21! William Nylander buries it, and it's 2-1 for 21!
Kinda perfect. You could tell that I realized it as I was saying it, so it wasn't very planned or smooth.
Alright, that's a much better way to head to intermission. Oh, we're not in intermission!
A little bit of making your own luck here. The Leafs dogged along the boards tonight, especially in the first period, generating these goals. The Capitals, though, kind of a soft target. Like, if you zoom in here, Michael Bunting's in a puck battle. This thing is loose. Like, Matthews knows it's loose. That's why he's going after it. Kuznetsov has had time to go after this puck, and he just doesn't. Matthews able to clean him out and gives it to Bunting. Bunting with a good effort along the boards and low-key kind of dangles Ovechkin. Morgan Riley puts it on, and then Justin Hall, knowing that there's only about 5 seconds left in the period, says, "It's time for net front presence, Justin Hall!" Justin Joe Actual Pavelski Hall makes it 3-1 with just over a second to go in the first. The Leafs head to the second with a 3-1 lead. Yes! No! Ah!
Oh, man! Ah! Steve, you're being ridiculous! Yeah! No, but I never played the game growing up. No, I've just been documenting every game for like 15 years. Never happens. I'm sure it'll be fine.
And while it wasn't fine, and the Leafs did blow the 3-1 lead, I didn't think it was entirely their fault. I mean, let's be honest, as easy as it is to pick on the Leafs, and sometimes it's warranted. I mean, when they do it like 5 games in a row or whatever it was, yeah, it's okay to point it out. But also in 2022, a 3-1 lead is not as safe as it once was. It's definitely not as safe when there's 40 minutes to go in the game, and it's definitely not safe against the Washington Capitals, who have Alexander Ovechkin, Nick Backstrom, etc. And also, kinda hard when you're getting called for stuff you didn't do! Penalties in the second period were 3-1 in favor of the Washington Capitals, as in the Toronto Maple Leafs took 3, and it should have been 1-1. Now, it's easy to be like, oh, biased Leaf fan, you're salty, and yeah, on some of those 50-50 calls, oh, you know, it shouldn't have been this, oh, that's a soft call. I get it. But tripping is kind of, like, tripping. Like, you either did or didn't do it. Now, in the back half of the second period, pretty confidently, Michael Bunting didn't do it, and very confidently, in the first half of the second period, Pierre Engvall definitely didn't do it! Engvall, who barely has a finger on Tom Wilson, is called for the trip as Wilson just kind of falls! And I mean, I'm not making fun of him, he's a far better skater than me, have you ever seen it? But he didn't trip him! And the official who puts their arm up and makes the call is like 10, 15 feet away from it happening. I'm sure it happened very fast, but it wasn't a trip and it wasn't close to one, and the Capitals get a power play. In which Tom Wilson scores! On a play, by the way, it was a 50-50 chance, should have been blown dead because of a high stick. Basically what happened, the Washington Capitals bat the puck down with the high stick. The Leafs sorta, almost, arguably, it's difficult to tell, get possession. Capitals get it back, and then they score. The argument is that the Leafs did not have full possession, meaning the Capitals should have been called for the high stick. The play should have been blown dead. Well, the play wasn't blown dead on the penalty that shouldn't have been a penalty, and the Caps cut the lead to 1. I don't think that's anybody's fault. Sorry, anybody's fault on the Leafs. It's definitely the ref's fault. It's all their fault. Leafs get a power play of their own. They don't capitalize. The Capitals' penalty kill was very good in this game. And then Bunting takes a trip on Lars Eller, and it just wasn't a trip. Yes, he had the stick between the legs. It could have been heading in the direction of trip. But one of Eller's skates hits the boards. The other one just kind of buckles in this way that I think is a toe pick. I tweeted that he dove, but I don't know how you get your body to move like that voluntarily. Basically, like a half dozen things happen to Lars Eller in about 1 second, and none of them were tripping by Michael Bunting. But he's called for it anyway. Luckily, the Leafs kill it off. But again, that's 2 blown calls as they're trying to defend a lead. Ironically, less than a minute into the third period, the Leafs get a power play. And ironically, less than 2 minutes into the third period, Tom Wilson gets one again, this time shorthanded. Leafs fail to hold the line. It's a 2-on-1 for the Washington Capitals. Wilson, with an option to pass, just snipes it. Now, goalies, I'm gonna need your help on this one because I'm not sure how to feel. Because there were some stinkers, like legitimately terrible goals in the Detroit game. Is this a stinker? Because, all right, it's a 2-on-1, so already I'm like, probably not the goalie's fault. It's a good shot from Wilson, and sometimes good shots are gonna go in. But correct me if I'm wrong, Peter Mrazek has a very complicated relationship with his goalposts. Like, he is deep, deep, deep in there, and he's always just like a little askew to me from where he should be. In case you want to know what it looks like from the other side. Like, is it just me, or is that an awful lot of net for Tom Wilson to shoot at? Like, a lot of net. And also, Mrazek is blocking some of the side of the net, which, You don't need to do. I looked it up. Those don't count. So here we are, not the greatest goal, not the greatest situation, but it's tied 3-3. And the building is rocking. I've been to Washington, D.C. for a book signing. I've never been there for a game. I badly want to go. That barn seems amazing. The atmosphere, so good. That's part of the reason you got those two tripping calls, Washington. They're afraid of you. And while the building's rocking, it's getting louder and louder and louder throughout the third. And the hits are getting bigger and bigger. Bigger and bigger, and Hathaway is just a wrecking ball out there. Michael Bunting and Hathaway, like Michael Bunting, I'm not gonna say Michael Bunting was in Hathaway's kitchen, but he was like within spitting distance, you know? It's a joke because he spat on a guy, which is gross. Who thinks to do that? Honestly, he did it, look it up. Eric Branson, was he out of his mind? Anyway, the intensity is ramping up and this is starting to get a bad vibe. There were a few hits from the Leafs in response, but the Capitals were obviously the heavier team, the harder hitting team, the more aggressive team. Wayne Simmonds got in there a little, and that was fun, and Nick Robertson was in this game? What do you do? He wears 89, right? Is this Nick Robertson? Okay, we'll have to talk about that later. But the intensity is ramping up, and there was a moment where Tom Wilson bowls John Tavares over, and it drove me nuts. I know it drove a lot of Leafs Nation nuts, but nothing. Nothing from the team. That's your captain, and nothing? Now, first of all, John Tavares' line mates are William Nylander and Alexander Kerfoot. How do you think the voting's gonna go on hockeyfights.com for the Tom Wilson versus Alexander Kerfoot fight? I tell you what, William Nylander is the most beautiful Leaf for now. As much as I want to see them stand up for John Tavares, I don't think he should be opening that door. I think a lot of lessons can be learned from the way John Tavares handled this. Because he got up. He didn't whine, he didn't try to punch anyone in the face, he just got up. And when he got up, he did an amazing thing. He played hockey, and he dekes out Jensen, and he fights off Ferravari! Sends it in front to Justin Holl, who's winding up, and he passes. Ilya Samsonov was no longer in the net for the Washington Capitals, it was actually Vitek Vanacek, and do you want to see the body language of a goalie who knows they just screwed up? Look at that! Oh, I've made a terrible mistake. Yes, you have. That's right. That's a shame. John Tavares with his best game in a long stretch, giving it to Justin Holl with his best game maybe the season, feeds Rasmus Sandin with the dagger. Well, maybe not the dagger, but he did give the Leafs the lead. And then Engvall with the empty netter, a dagger. Watching him just outskate everybody. David Kampf with the amazing effort to even get the puck in that scenario. And that's the dagger. The Leafs win. Leading to this question that I got more than once. Is this game an example of scissors beating rock? For those of you who are unfamiliar, the way I talk about the Leafs is they are an elite pair of scissors. They're one of the best scissors in the league, but when they run into rock, the St. Louis Blues, the Calgary Flames, they can win, but they struggle. In this case against the Washington Capitals, I don't know if I would use a rock, paper, scissors analogy. What I would instead use is Pokemon types. For example, water type Pokemon will beat fire type Pokemon because water puts out fire. But fire Pokemon will beat plant Pokemon because fire sets plants on fire. But plant Pokemon will beat water type Pokemon because, well, water can't hurt a plant. It's just water feeds plants, so plants will beat water. But anyone who's ever played the game knows that's not always the case. Anyone who's ever tried to take care of a plant knows that it's possible to drown the plant! And that is what the Leafs did here against the Washington Capitals. It wasn't necessarily a rock versus scissors game all night. It's like why aren't we referring to the Capitals as a pair of scissors? They have Alexander Ovechkin. They've had him since 2005, actually. Well, 2004, there was a stupid lockout, though. This is how the Washington Capitals won a Stanley Cup, by the way. They are a pair of scissors with the capability of using rock! Or to put it back in Pokemon terms, they were a plant-type Pokemon that learned poison attacks. And their plant attacks might not always work against fire, but fire definitely doesn't like to be poisoned! Make no mistake, these are two skilled teams, but at a certain point in the season, you gotta add a little bit more snarl. The Capitals did, and the Leafs didn't back down, and it worked. Did Tavares getting punched give you flashbacks to Chara and the Bruins that one time? Why does no one stand up for anyone in this team? Okay, no, it doesn't give me flashbacks to that, because this was Tom Wilson pushing down John Tavares after the whistle, which happens all the time. The incident you're thinking of, Game 7 from 2019, is Zdeno Chara punching John Tavares in the head and nothing happened, which that doesn't happen all the time. It just happens all the time in the playoffs. How is that not a penalty? Oh my God, NHL refs in the playoffs are wage theft. How dare you take any of that money for yourselves, you monsters. You didn't earn it. The rest of us had to pay to get in the building. Why didn't you? Anyway, I understand the problem that you're talking about. Why doesn't anyone stand up for anyone on this team? And I saw John Tavares and I'm like, that's your captain. What if he doesn't want it? Look at him. He did the talking himself. He did the walking himself. He didn't need it. That's a leader. That's the sort of example that I want to see the team take from.
You can't win every game.
Robert. Okay. Just incredible play by Hall tonight. Am I right?
Justin.
Yeah, I thought he had. Oh. Oh. Nicholas. Oh, no. That's not good.
Who told you that was good?
Nick? No. Nick's friends, be better. You gotta save him.
Is it still broken, mangled, and really unpleasant? Thank you, Yams.
For those of you who don't understand what Yams is talking about, that's referencing a joke that I made on my TikTok. I have a TikTok. You should check out my TikTok. STEVEDANGLE. All one word. It's like this, but it's on TikTok. Last but not least, I talked about this earlier. Nick Robertson played less than 6 minutes in this game, and he didn't kill any penalties, and he didn't play on the second line at all, and he didn't play on the second power play unit, and I'm gonna throw it out there. Don't do that. Why would you do that? Under what circumstance does it make sense to do that? Glad you won. Don't do that! Some people thrive in that role. He doesn't. Why would you do that?
He thinks there's a bit of a disconnect between the GM and coach on this one, and I hope they figure it out because this doesn't help Nick Robertson or the team's future at all.
But they won! Hooray!
So, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. It was a 2-podcast day on STPN, brand new Chris Johnston show. That show getting a little spicy as we head into the NHL trade deadline. And also, brand new Steve Dangle podcast that you haven't heard yet because it just got uploaded as I was shooting this video because Jesse just got home from Vegas. But it's up now. Go check it out. You just watch me talk for a long time. Go watch me talk for a longer time.